Christmas is almost here, and Christmas is my favorite time of the year. I love the smells, I love the lights, I love the way that the snow looks when it falls on the ground on Christmas morning. I love opening presents. I just love everything about Christmas, and it's almost here. But unfortunately, Christmas has been so tainted by materialism, by shopping sprees and the things we can get, that we've lost focus of what it's truly about. And so what we're going to do for the next 3 weeks is we're going to be doing a series through the Christmas story. And we're going to call it Vantage Point. Now, some of you may have seen the old movie Vantage Point. It's kind of be a little bit like that, where we're going to look at three different vantage points of the Christmas story. And as we do that, we're going to pull some perspectives from those vantage points and see how we can apply them to our lives. So without further ado, let's look at our first vantage point today. We're going to be in Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 8. Our first vantage point is that of the wise men. Let's read. Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose, and have come to worship him. When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all of Jerusalem with him. And assembling all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where Jesus Christ was to be born. They told him, In Bethlehem of Judea, for it is written by the prophet, And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means the least of rulers of Judah. For out of you shall come a ruler, who will shepherd my people Israel. When Herod summoned the wise men secretly, and ascertained from them what time the star had appeared, he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, Go, search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word, that I may come and worship him. Now, we know the Christmas story. We know that King Herod really wasn't interested in worshiping the King Jesus. No, in fact, he wanted to kill Jesus. In fact, as we look at the character of Herod, he's just another Old Testament king that has control issues. And we haven't started the New Testament. Well, we have started the New Testament. And so he's this king that has control issues. But what's interesting about Herod is it said that he practiced Judaism. So he knew who this Messiah was. He knew what he was going to be about. But he was a little bit paranoid. In fact, some people think that Herod actually killed his wife and child because he didn't want any threat to the throne. And so he had control issues, and he didn't want there to be another king. In fact, if we look at verse 3 in a different translation, it says that Herod was deeply disturbed. He did not want there to be another king, and so he sent these wise men out as spies to go find Jesus and report back to him when they find him. Now let's take a look here and see what the wise men do. In Matthew chapter 2, verses 9 through 12. After listening to the king, they went on their way, and behold, the star that they had seen when it rose went before them, until it came to rest over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother. And they fell down and worshipped him. Then opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And being warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they went to their own country their own way. So here we see these wise men. They find the baby Jesus, but they don't go back to Herod and tell him that. It's because God told them not to. God comes to the wise men in a dream and says, don't go back to Herod. He wants to harm my son. And so these wise men, they obey God and go against the king's instructions. And I think that's what we need to hear today. And it's this principle that it takes courage to do what's right. It takes courage to do what's right, because sometimes the right thing isn't always the easy thing. And it takes courage to do what's right. And that's why it's so important that we as Christians are people of integrity. That we're the same people behind closed doors that we are in the open. That we do what we say we're going to do. Because God's looking for people who will do the right thing even when it's hard. Doing the right thing sometimes means doing what is hard. Now, there's a story of a store in New Jersey called Buddy's Big Lots. And one day, the manager was working in their office, and all of a sudden, she got an alert from her security system that four men had broken into the store. And she watches on the security camera as they take items off the shelves and bring them over to the register, where she assumes that they're going to steal money. They're gonna take things that don't belong to them, and they're gonna go get the money. But what we find them do is one man pulls the money out of his pocket, it points at it, waves in front of the security camera, and lays it on the counter. See, these four men were actually four college students, and they thought the store was open. And they were in between classes, and I guess everyone was on their lunch break, and they left the money on the cashier's, on that table, paying for what they took. And they even left enough money for tax. And so this store owner tracks these students down. And this is kind of sad, but these students are rewarded for doing the right thing. Well, we live in a world where we're rewarded for doing the right thing. We shouldn't expect people to do the wrong thing. But more often than not, people choose to do the wrong thing over the right thing. And so when we see people do the right thing, we want to reward them. We want to say, that's different. That's something special. And we want to honor that. And so the store manager gave them a gift card to the store, saying, thank you guys for being people of integrity. Here's a second principle I want to tell you guys today. And it's doing the right thing may not always be the safe thing. And doing the right thing may not be the safe thing. I think about the early church and how so often they were trying to follow God. They were trying to do the right thing. And we know that's the right thing, but some were killed for doing the right thing, for putting their faith in Jesus. And as we look at this story of the wise men, we see that the right thing to do was not to go tell Herod, because God told them not to. And they did that. But think about that. They were disobeying the king's orders, and if the king would have caught them, he probably would have killed them. They were doing something dangerous, and it wasn't safe, but they were doing the right thing. And that's why it's so important in every opportunity we have to do the right thing. And if we need to think for ourselves, what happens if we don't do the right thing? I want to share this verse with you from James chapter 4, verse 17. It says, "So whoever knows the right thing to do and fails to do it, for him, it is sin." It is sin to know the right thing to do, but not do it. And so as we think about our life and our culture today, we find many of the right things to do go against our culture. And as we listen to God's leading, and as he tells us the right thing to do, the right way to go, we find ourselves at a crossroads. We find ourselves that we can't go on living the way that we've been living. Because if we do, we're eventually going to sin. We're going to do something that God doesn't want us to do, and we're going to know in our conscience that we did what was wrong. We didn't do the good thing. And so James is telling us that it's sin. And so what we need to do, as we conclude, is to look at these wise men, who were men of integrity, people who looked for the right thing to do, and they did it. Even when it was hard, you're on the run away from a king. And ask ourselves, if we're truly going to be wise people, then we need to do what is right. We need to do what is right before our God. Thanks, guys, for tuning in. I hope you guys will tune into the other weeks of the study as we begin to look at two more perspectives on the Christmas story. Thanks, guys, and have a great day.